Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to ABO's Electrical Training Today monthly webinar series. Today's topic is basic electrical troubleshooting. And my name is Jamie Smith, and I'm the marketing manager for ABO Training Institute, and I'll be acting as the moderator for today's presentation and supporting you on any technical issues or questions for our presenter. On the right side of your screen, you'll see a control panel that looks similar to this one. You can submit questions at any time during the presentation by typing in the box highlighted in red, and I will read those questions out during the Q&A segment at the end of the webinar. All webinar attendees are eligible to receive one NEDA CTD and one PDH or 0.1 CEU just for attending today, and you will receive that in an email within about 2 to 3 business days of the webinar. That email will also include a copy of the PowerPoint presentation and a link to the video recording if you'd like to watch it again or share it with your colleagues. That email will not include a certificate. It'll just be proof of attendance that you'll have to submit for credit. Also, remember, you can ask questions at any time during the presentation, and they will be answered at the end of the webinar during the Q&A session. And before we get started, I just want to go over a few things that are new that's going on at ABO right now. As some of you are aware, as of May 1st of this year, we received ISET accreditation. ISET stands for International Association for Continuing Education and Training, and they developed the original Continuing Education Unit, or CEU, as you probably refer to it as. What does this mean for ABO? It means our company has gained a major competitive advantage that most electrical training companies are currently unable to provide by demonstrating our commitment to best practices and professional training through mastering ISET's rigorous accreditation program. And what does it mean for our students? It's really just proof that our training you receive through ABO is one of the highest quality around, that CEUs are transferable between cooperating organizations, and just knowing that your employees or your coworkers are properly trained to remain safe day in and day out. What else do we have going on? We have 2 new courses that were added this year, microprocessor-based relay testing feeder protection and microprocessor-based relay testing transformer protection. If you'd like more information on either of those courses, please let us know in the comments box on the survey, and we'll definitely have an account executive reach out to you. Also, we've added 2 new training locations, one in Elgin, Illinois, near Chicago at Circuit Breaker Sales, and the other in Houston, Texas at Powell Electrical Systems. You can visit our website and the locations drop down to view details and course schedules for each of those new locations as well. And lastly, ABO and Megger Dallas will be moving into a new facility later this year. Should be in November. The new facility is just 6 miles north of our current facility, but it's twice the size, a lot nicer, and we have some great ideas that we plan to implement into that new facility, to help with our students' training in the future. All right, let's go ahead and get started. Today, our presenter is Rick Gaskell, Senior Training Specialist for ABO Training Institute. All right, thank you for joining us today, Rick.
I'd like to welcome everybody this morning. We're going to talk about basic electrical troubleshooting, some different methods and strategies to employ, different test equipment we can use to accomplish troubleshooting tasks, a little bit on symbols and symbology and electrical symbols and electrical devices. We're going to talk about 3-phase motors, motor starters, magnetic overload relays, some starting methods, how to troubleshoot those. Look at some procedures for troubleshooting AC motors and starters. Process for troubleshooting direct current machines, such as generators. Look at some power electronic components, variable speed drives. How do we troubleshoot switches, circuit breakers, and switchboards? And different procedures for troubleshooting control circuits. So this first part, this first section, we're going to talk about the basics of troubleshooting, different techniques, various measuring devices, test equipment, their function, and what test methods can we employ with them, that test equipment. So these little bit of sections here at the first, we'll talk about symbols, different meters, how to read a control circuit, what we're trying to do is build a skill set. Start with a basic skill set and build on it. Troubleshooting is a never-ending evolution. We're constantly trying to build our skills. So the first part here, we're going to talk about a series circuit. Of course, you have to have a source, path, and a load. We need to be able to recognize how the components are connected in a circuit. Help us troubleshoot the circuit. There's two kind of problems that generally exist. Short circuit and an open circuit. An open circuit is a path where there should be one. And a short circuit is where there's a path where there should not be one. So the process of detecting those faults and rectifying the circuit to restore it to normal operation is what we call troubleshooting. So we're going to talk about the open circuit fault first. Current has a tendency to flow between two points, and they're at an unequal potential electrically, provided the path between the two points is electrically conductive. So we have three basic values we're looking for in a circuit. We're looking at resistance, which we refer to as ohms, and our electrical potential, our EMF, we designate as volts. And then the flow of electrons between two points, which is current, we measure in amps. So troubleshooting, we have to check the following points. We have to have continuity of a path. And continuity is nothing more than a continuous. Electrical potential at two points, our voltage, do we have a source? And then the flow of electrons through the path. So electrical circuits made up of different paths. Those paths can work on different voltages. So we need to be able to identify the path and also how it's completed. And if it's not complete, we need to identify the reason. So the first thing we need to look at is, do we have an incoming supply? Is the voltage there? Is it correct? We need to check the voltage at specific test points as per the manufacturer's data. Also, our engineered drawings that are site specific will be a great help in troubleshooting. Do a dead test of the circuit for integrity of the protection devices. So in a dead test or a de-energized test, that's where we want to check for continuity. We never want to check for continuity on an energized circuit. If it's not possible to perform the dead test, we need to connect the supply to the circuit and do a live test of the circuit. So generally, our electrical circuits can be divided into two sections. You have the power section and the control section. It's always advisable to first check the power circuit. So if the power circuit works as it should, then we can troubleshoot the control circuit. So checking the power circuit, we can have a checklist. We need to check the incoming power supply and its integrity. We need to check our functioning of our protection devices. Visual check on our cable continuity, and then any signs of flash or burning cell. We need to use our senses, sight, smell, touch, see if we can detect anything there. So we want to check the control circuit power first. When we're looking at the control circuit, do we have available potential? We want to check our devices, our relays, timers, and switches, and make sure they're functioning properly. We want to look at our cable and our wires and make sure we have cable continuity. And we also want to check our wire interconnections and our terminal connections first. We need to check the logical operation sequence of the contactor switching. Any timers that are in there, we need to check the durations of the settings and make sure they're set correctly. If we check all the above criteria and the motor is still not working, then we test the motor. That's the final check we do. So dead circuit testing is just what it implies. We're testing the circuit with the power disconnected. The main benefit of disconnecting the power supply while testing is to eliminate a hazardous risk for the environment that the person conducting the test. So as a continuity test as well as an insulation test can be performed with the circuit de-energized. So when we're doing a continuity test, we need to make sure the circuit's de-energized. We can use a device called an audible continuity tester. An audible continuity tester is just nothing more than a tester that gives you an audio tone or an audio alert. We can also use an ohm meter. We use an ohmmeter, a multimeter to check continuity. Gives us a little more precise information. So the continuity test, in short, we're using it to check the integrity of the cables. Do we have an electrical circuit path? Is there a path to ground? And then we can also use it to check accurate wiring of the control and power circuit. Is it terminated correctly per the engineered documentation? We can check for wrong wiring interconnections between the control and power circuits. And in doing this, we can find short circuit paths. We can also continuity to use it to check the integrity of switches, fuses, and other devices. So a few words of caution. Checking continuity in a control circuit can give you erratic results due to the existence of parallel paths. So if you're going to check continuity, a good practice is to isolate the component, remove it from the circuit. So another check associated with continuity is the insulation test. Again, this test needs to be performed on a circuit that's de-energized. And the whole objective of this test is to check the integrity of the installation of the power cables and your control wiring. So checking the integrity of the insulation is known as an insulation resistance test. So here in this slide here, we're looking at a motor. This is a typical power circuit for a three-phase motor. And what's depicted there in the drawing is we have the overcurrent device isolated from the circuit as well as the motor. And this allows us to check the integrity of each phase going to that motor. So we get an accurate reading or a indication of the integrity of that conductor and its insulation from the overcurrent device to the motor. So we want to check from terminal T1 and T2 to ground. We want to make sure we don't have a path to earth. We can also use two lamps and with a power supply. And if we check between those phases, we should have a continuous path and get an illumination on the circuit. So our probes and tools we use, they need to be insulated. It gives us a minimum exposure to the live conducting parts. This will also minimize the inadvertent bridging of two terminals, which are different potentials, which can cause a short circuit, leading to exposure to the technician. So most of the tests we detailed are looking for resistance leakage path and resistance of a conductor for the known application. So we're looking for a path to ground. That's what we're trying to avoid. We also want to keep in mind the location of the protection devices. Where are they at? What are their ratings? Also, the selection of the cable type and selection of the cable due to the environmental conditions we're going to put them in. Electrical equipment, make sure it's rated for the environment it's going to be exposed to, as well as the installation of the electrical equipment and conductors per the manufacturer. So all these situations we talked to previously need to be done during the installation phase of the electrical system. So if we do that during the installation phase, it'll reduce the need for additional troubleshooting and also verify the integrity of the system's good before we put it in service. So to successfully troubleshoot in a short time, you need to understand the measurement meters, different test equipment, and how they can be used and their functions. So we'll talk about this in the next few slides. So here we have a lamp indicator. We're using these lamps. We're trying to check a live circuit. It is fused. If we have a continuous path and we have a live circuit, the lamps will illuminate. So we could use a lamp indicator on several different applications. Most common, we're trying to detect the presence of live voltage. Testing a motor, what testing devices do we use? We want to check for an earth condition. So those lamps could be used to connect to a winding single phase supply, and the second lead to the other winding. If the winding's earth, the lamps will glow. If there's not a path to ground, you won't get any illumination out of the lamps. Present day voltage testers, when correctly handled, are safe for live testing. One such voltage tester known is a high impedance tester. Gives you an audible alert, a visual and an audible alert sometimes. Just depends on the tester and the manufacturer. So some of the comparisons between an analog and digital instrument. An analog meter is going to give you a reading by movement of a needle on a calibrated scale, whereas a digital multimeter is going to give you a digital readout, a little more accurate. It's easier for a user to differentiate between the readings on an analog meter rather than a digital one because you're going to see small change in circuit parameters. And also for testing continuity, an analog meter is a better choice. Again, you're going to see small changes in your circuit parameters. So on a testing device, an analog testing device, an open circuit will read full-scale deflection and show an infinite reading. For a closed circuit, it'll show zero resistance, thereby misleading the user. In other words, you don't get no movement out of your analog meter. For potential difference, measuring voltage between two points, we use a voltmeter. Of course, this is going to be used in testing a live energized circuit. The voltage measurement is made by connecting the voltmeter across the test points of the circuit. A voltmeter can be employed to measure AC or DC voltage in different ranges. So if you're going to measure AC voltage, you need to have the meter in the AC selection. So a voltmeter is always connected in parallel. When you're using a voltmeter, you need to ensure that the proper range of voltage is selected prior to putting the meter in the circuit. Failure to maintain the above-mentioned precautions will result in safety hazards to both you and the instrument. Accordingly, the measurement scale requires a multiplication factor. So if you're using an analog meter, that selection has a multiplication factor inside the meter. So we use a voltmeter for the following purposes. We want to test the continuity of the power of an electrical circuit. We could also check the integrity of single and three-phase power. We can check the devices, relays and timers. We can check their integrity. And we can also check and see if we have a path to ground. Another testing device we can use for troubleshooting is an ammeter. An ammeter is going to measure the current flowing through a circuit. In addition, some of the precautions for an ammeter, it has to be used on a live circuit. So for that reason, when we're measuring high currents, we want to use a clamp-type ammeter. For lower currents, it's probably more permissible and get a more accurate representation with a multimeter. So here we got a voltmeter and an ammeter. You can see the different connections and the different application for each meter. Your voltmeter on the right-hand side is connected in parallel, where the ammeter is in series with the circuit. The current actually flows through the meter. So for that reason, we want to use an ammeter connected in this scenario for smaller current. So for very high voltage circuits, it's unfeasible to disturb the circuit to take a physical connection with the meter. So for that reason, we want to use a clamp-on meter, such as the one here depicted in the slide. So a clamp-on ammeter, as the name suggests, is a handheld device that's clamped around the current. The basic principle remains the same, except we're using a current transformer. Calibrates the current reading on a calibrated scale. So here we have another photo of a clamp meter being used. This device will work for AC and DC ranges of various current. It also has a hold function, which will hold the reading. So for various other current readings, smaller current, we can use a multimeter. This is an analog multimeter that's pictured. So various companies have very different models with meters with very different functions. Some multimeters come with an ammeter, voltmeter, and ohmmeter. As with any piece of test equipment, you need to read the manufacturer's documentation and be familiar with your meter before you actually put it in service. So this combination of volt, ohm, milliamp meter is a basic tool for troubleshooting. It's probably the most common. So before we put the meter in the circuit, we need to know what voltage we anticipate to see before we actually put the meter in the circuit. We can use our one-line diagrams, our engineered documentation to verify that. When we're making a test for voltage, we want to pay attention to polarity. Also, keep in mind whether it's an AC or DC voltage. When checking resistance with a multimeter, again, we want to make sure the power supply is de-energized. If we use the multimeter in the ohm setting on an energized circuit, we may damage the meter or may subject ourselves to a safety hazard. Check your batteries frequently to ensure the accuracy of the resistance scale. You can also verify the fuses on most multimeters for the current portion of the meter by putting the meter in the ohms function, putting your test lead in the volt ohms jack, and then taking the other end of that test lead and touching the amp jacks of your multimeter. If you do this and you get a resistance reading, you're verifying the fuses inside your multimeter. If you have a multimeter that is calibrated, a lot of times taking the instrument apart to check those fuses will void the calibration. So this will help you keep you from voiding the calibration on your multimeter. Protect the instrument from dust, dirt, moisture, fumes, and heat. We want to make sure we store it correctly. So what are the advantages of digital multimeter? We have easy functionality. Digital multimeter helps us take a lot of the human error out of our voltage measurements. And it's able to measure multiple parameters, right? Voltage, current, resistance can all be used, can all be measured using a multimeter. Multimeter also has an outer range function. Again, we're trying to take the human error part of it out. A lot of these meters today, if you're measuring voltage, you just stick it over in the voltage selection. The meter is going to pick up whether it's AC or DC, and it's also going to select the correct range for you. Digital multimeters, most of them today have a hole function on them, so I don't actually have to be looking at the screen when I take my measurement. I can set the meter aside, concentrate on where I'm taking the measurement from, back out of the piece of equipment with my leads off the test points, and look at my screen, and it'll give me a reading of what I was measuring. Has auto polarity feature. Again, you can look in the display and see if it's a positive or negative voltage. I don't have to select that. Most of your multimeters have a minimum and maximum function to hold those values. They also offer some other features, such as we can test diodes, transistors, capacitors, and temperature if your meter is equipped with that function. So here we're looking at a digital multimeter. What I found curious on this meter that I haven't seen before is if you look up in the screen, it gives you the volts, ohms, diode, and gives you two circles there. And what this meter is telling you is where to connect your test leads for the function you have selected. They're getting better and better with this test equipment as time goes on. And again, the whole idea is to make this operation or this evolution of troubleshooting safer. So to operate the meter, we need to perform it in the following steps. Before we connect it to the circuit, we need to make sure that the probes are connected in the proper jack for the function we've selected. Need to make sure we don't mix multimeter leads between manufacturers. We want to make sure we get a good connection. If the meter doesn't have an auto range function, we need to make sure we have the selector switch in the right range. To measure voltage too, we can use an oscilloscope. Again, we got modes and selections. It'll also allow you to measure an AC or DC voltage. It'll give you the amplitude. A lot of old scopes have a dual trace, so I can measure two voltages at the same time, and it let me do a comparison real time. The old scope will store your waveform, store your reading, just like a multimeter. Of course, it has a power switch for on and off. Has isolation between ground and earth. Has two channels, A and a B channel, so again, I can do some comparison on my voltage readings. Again, you need to read your manufacturer's documentation on how to operate your test equipment. Make sure you're familiar with it before you actually put it in service. So, what are some safety standards for measuring instruments for our test equipment? While a person is conducting a test with an instrument on a live circuit, there's a possibility for a sharp rise in voltage for a short duration. This may result in an arc flash between the measurement terminals of the testing device. If a heavy flash occurs, the person could be critically injured while they're handling the instrument. The IEC has divided multimeters into four categories, depending on the environment you're going to put them in. Just realize that a category 4 meter could be rated less at a less voltage than Category 3 meter. So again, we need to look at our manufacturer's documentation and make sure we have the right meter selected for the environment we're getting ready to put it in. Insulation resistance testers or meggers. Commonly called a meg test or a megger test. The whole purpose of this test is to test the integrity of the insulation. We're trying to verify the integrity of the insulation before we actually put the device in service. So why do we use a megger, insulation resistance tester? Most of our multimeters do not provide an accurate indication above 10 megohms. So the megger is essentially a portable ohm meter with a built-in high voltage source. Most of your DC meggers produce a voltage of 500, 1,000, or 2,500 volts. Again, it depends on the model and manufacturer. There's a battery in the instrument. That's what's generating your test voltage. The resistance is directly displayed on the panel. Could be a analog display or a digital display. So here is the old hand crank insulation resistance tester. Wasn't very accurate because you had to turn the crank to generate the voltage, and while that was happening, the meter deflection or the needle deflection was very erratic. Here's an electronic version of an insulation resistance tester. Again, there's all types of manufacturers. Here is a megger insulation resistance tester. This instrument here is designed for final test of circuits. Give you phase rotation, insulation resistance, voltage. So long story short, the devices need to be understood, and how are we going to apply them? So those testing principles are very important before we use such testing devices. We need to know how to use them, where they're used, what environment they're used in. Something else that can help us become a better technician is knowing circuit theory, schematic symbols, how they behave in the circuit, different terminology for switches, such as normally open and normally closed, being able to realize or pick out on a schematic diagram level switches, pressure switches, temperature switches, when do they operate, what are their normal condition. To be able to troubleshoot electrical equipment, we need to know the location of the equipment, what environment is it in, and we need a wiring diagram. How is it connected? The wiring diagram is going to give us information such as wire labels, tag numbers, connections, relays, termination points, junction boxes, etc. So here is a typical three-phase wiring diagram. Again, this is a three-phase motor. The overcurrent device is shown. The fuses are shown. The contacts of the motor starter are shown, as well as your overloads. So again, some of the things we can look for: checking the correct polarity, making sure the polarity matches the engineered documentation we're using, ensuring that there's no short circuits, or also verifying the connection and termination of the wires. Ensuring that there's no interconnection between two different circuits. Correctly identifying circuit loads such as contactors, relays, and their contacts. And active conductors and their corresponding neutral conductors to check the integrity of the circuit. Are we sharing a neutral when we really shouldn't be? So a continuity test, again, is useful to detect a short circuit condition. Continuity test can help us pick up incorrect termination of wires, any insulation breakdown, or any incorrect connection at a field junction box. So again, here is trying to detect a connection to ground, an earth connection. So before this test, we need to disconnect the neutral link from the circuit and close all contactors and switches. We need to check all the direct interconnections with the low range ohm meter. If the resistance on the low range ohm meter is very low, then we have a short circuit condition. After that's performed, we need to check the insulation resistance of the cable. We can do this with an insulation resistance test. If the resistance we read is less than 1 megohm, then it can be said that the wiring or device has an insulation problem. That 1 megohm value may change due to the requirements for your company or your client or your installation. So to perform an insulation resistance test, we want to check the integrity of the leads by shorting the test leads. This should give us a zero resistance. If the leads are kept open, you should see an infinite resistance. The section we're trying to test, we need to isolate it from the power supply, make sure it's de-energized, and we need to select the proper operating voltage on our insulation resistance tester depending on the rating of the system. We need to check for connections while we're conducting the test. Only the section to be tested is included in the test. We want to isolate whatever it is we're checking, whatever cable or conductor or motor we're trying to check. Before starting the test, we need to ensure that all capacitors that may be in the circuit are discharged. Before we touch the ends of the cable, after we test it, we need to discharge any energy that might be stored in the cables. So some optional tests we can use. We can use mega testing devices for a single phase system. Again, it's done the same way as we talked about earlier, disconnecting and isolating the circuit from power. We can also do an insulation resistance test of a motor. Again, we need to isolate the motor from the power supply. We want to check each winding of the motor to earth, make sure we don't have a path to ground. This graphic here on this slide, we've got the motor isolated, and we're using a mega test to verify we have an open between the motor and earth, or between the motor and ground. Here we have the motor connected to the supply cable, but we have the overcurrent device open. So in this connection or this configuration here, we're getting a full picture from the overcurrent device out to the motor. We're verifying the cable and the motor with one reading. The next slide is checking the isolation between the windings. Also checking the isolation between the windings and ground. These should show an infinite resistance or a real high resistance. So with that, that concludes the presentation. I'll turn it back over to Jamie, and he'll finish up.
Good. All right. Thank you, Rick. At this time, the presentation portion of the webinar is officially concluded. We'll now take 30 minutes to answer as many questions as possible. If you have any questions you haven't already submitted them, please submit them now into the Q&A box on the right side of your screen. And for those that are leaving, when you close the webinar window, a survey should pop up on the screen. We'd greatly appreciate it if you could take a couple minutes to provide your feedback so that we can continue to improve upon future webinars. And also, a copy of the PowerPoint presentation along with a link to the video recording of the webinar will also be emailed to everyone within about 2 to 3 business days, so expect that around mid next week. All right, now let's get to some of your questions. All right, first question was, how do you calibrate a multimeter on your own?
Digital multimeter, there's really no calibration. You probably need to send it off to a recognized laboratory. For a Simpson multimeter, analog multimeter, a lot of times they'll have a zero adjust function to make up the difference in meter leads if you were to swap meter leads of a different length. But other than that, you probably need to send it off to an approved laboratory to have it calibrated.
All right. Another question was from Wallace. When would you use an O-scope over a digital meter?
The O-scope is going to give you a visual representation of the waveform or the DC voltage. So if you're looking for a more precise measurement, maybe you've got some frequency issues, some intermittent computer issues, that would be a good time to employ an O-scope. It gives you a more accurate representation of the voltage versus the information garnered from a digital multimeter.
All right. Next question was from Jack. What does polarity refer to? I'm not sure which slide that was on, but...
Polarity is a term that we use when we're talking about DC voltage with respect to ground. So we're just trying to verify that we have the polarity correct. That's determined by the equipment need. So every instance is going to be different with respect to polarity. So manufacturer's documentation is a good place to start with that.
All right, thank you. Next question. If a customer has no drawings for their equipment, where do you start to troubleshoot and help understand their system?
A good place to start is with the manufacturer's documentation. I know a lot of times stuff is redlined or corrected in the field and the drawings get updated with a pencil, and it never gets catted up, so you got an accurate drawing. So if you have the time ahead of time, it's good to do a walk down. You can do a sketch of the system and give you a hand-drawn schematic so you have a reference.
All right, thank you. Next question was from Vishal. Why should the CT secondary not be kept open?
You have a high voltage potential in the secondary of the CT is not shorted out, and it's a pretty hazardous condition. So when you're disconnecting a CT on the secondary, you want to make sure it's shorted out before you disconnect it.
All right, next question was from Salvador. Are you able to do an insulation resistance test on a generator, and if so, how?
You can. That can be done. You need to isolate the windings. Make sure you're isolated and you're only testing the winding that's under test or in question. Same scenario, same practice, same test that you would test the motor in.
All right. Next question was from Stefan, what is the best way to test solid-state relays?
Solid-state relay, out of the box, you're going to see an open condition. Solid-state relay typically is a 3 to 32-volt DC input. To get those contacts to close, you're going to have a source voltage on the contacts.
Next question. How is a sheath test carried on power cable?
I don't know what they're referring to.
Yeah, I'm not sure what that is. Okay. Let's go to the next one. Could you repeat the methods for checking the fuss on your multimeter?
The fuse?
The fuse, sorry.
I think you're referring to the fuse that's on the input for the current, I believe. Most multimeters, you can select the ohm range, the resistance range on your multimeter. Take one of your leads, preferably the red lead, so we're performing the same function at the same time. We don't want to put the black lead in the red jack. We're building bad habits. So you want to put your red lead in the volt ohm jack. Have your multimeter selected on the ohm range. Take the probe tip of your lead and put it in the amp jack. If that fuse is good internally in the meter, you will read a resistance on the meter, on the display, on the LCD. If you read an open, the fuse is bad. At that point, you're going to have to open the meter anyway to replace the fuse, and if it's calibrated, it's really a moot point. But if the fuse is good, you don't want to take the meter apart and void your calibration, so you can use that test method to check your fuses without having to take the meter apart.
All right. Thank you, Rick. Next question was from David. How do you test capacitors?
The capacitance function, if your meter has one, you can put your meter in capacitance. You can look at the side of the capacitor. It'll have a value on it. It's either going to be microfarads or picofarads. It's also going to give you a tolerance. Usually it's plus or minus 5 or plus or minus 10. There are capacitors that have no tolerance. And whatever the capacitor's mark is the value for the capacitor. So you'll put your multimeter in the capacitance range or function or mode that's on your meter. Make sure you have your meter leads in the proper jack for your meter. Put your meter leads on the capacitor. You should read a capacitance value. You'll have to do the tolerance plus or minus 5 or plus or minus 10. If the capacitor is within that range, it's good. Just keep in mind that if your capacitor dropping in value, it's probably not going to get any better, right? It's not going to, electrical components don't fix themselves. So if it's starting to fall off, and you don't want to come back and get another call to come back for the same problem, and your capacitor is not at the specific value that's on there, even though it's within the tolerance, you probably want to replace it. Another way to check a capacitor, if you don't have the capacitance function, it's not going to give you the capacitance of the capacitor, but it will tell you if the capacitor is charging and discharging. So you can put your multimeter in the ohms function. You can put your meter leads on the capacitor. You will be using your meter as a source to charge the capacitor. Once the display settles down and it's not moving anymore, you're not getting a changing value, put your meter over them on volts and put your meter leads on the capacitor. You should see an initial voltage and you should see that voltage fall off. And what that's telling you is the capacitor's charging and discharging. What it doesn't give you is a specified range for that capacitor that's marked on the side of the capacitor.
All right, thank you. Next question was from Stan. Could you repeat the checklist for troubleshooting a control circuit?
First thing we want to check is to make sure we have power available. Typically on your control circuit for a motor starter, you're going to have a control transformer. So my first voltage check, or the safest place I can take that reading, is on the secondary of my control transformer. If I have voltage there, there's probably not any need to check the three phase. So once I verify I have power available on the secondary of the transformer, if there's an overcurrent device, which there typically is on the X1 side of your control transformer, typically a fuse, I want to verify the integrity of the fuse. Then I can start looking at my control devices, such as switches and coils and overloads and stuff like that, and make sure they're functioning correctly.
All right. Thank you. Next question. Can you discuss arc-rated clothing and gloves? I don't think that was covered.
Wasn't.
Is that a longer?
Yeah, that's a longer answer. That's probably, we have a engineering arm here at AVO that does short circuit studies, arc flash studies. If that's something you need, please call in AVO and we can put you in contact with the folks that take care of that for us here.
All right. Next question was from Cody. My meter will read continuity on an open circuit with the leads one way, but if you flip the leads, it won't read continuity. Why is that?
I think you have defective meter leads, or you've got a bad connection where your meter leads plug into your meter.
Okay. Thank you. Looks like that's all the questions we have for now. If there is anybody that has additional questions, I actually just had one more come in. This is actually from the last question you just answered, but he said they read a 100 volt on a Fluke multimeter on a PIC module, but when we grabbed a Wiggy, there wasn't any voltage. After further observation, there wasn't any voltage. Why was the meter incorrect?
Could be a myriad of problems. Again, I would send it into a certified calibration lab and have it verified. If you're getting erroneous readings with a piece of test equipment, you want to take it out of service. You don't want to continue to use it.
All right. Okay, another question just came in. What is an arc flash?
An arc flash is a path where there shouldn't be a path. If I have any welders out there, when you're welding, you're creating an arc. I can control the intensity of that arc by turning my welding machine up or down. The same thing happens in an arc flash, only it's uncontrolled. It's not planned for. It's not something I'm trying to produce on purpose. So if you have any experience welding or have any exposure to that, welding is a controlled arc flash.
All right. Thank you, Rick. Anybody else have any questions? One. Okay. This one, could you explain true RMS as indicated on digital meters?
We'll have to pick that up offline.
Okay.
You
can answer that one offline. That's a little more in-depth for that one. But thank you, Stan. All right. Here's another one from Jack. He's just asking about the PowerPoints. Yes, we'll definitely send a copy of the PowerPoint to everybody next week. All right, looks like that's all the questions that we have for now. Like I was saying, if you have any other questions, feel free to reach out to myself or Rick, and we can answer those offline or later for you. You can always contact us anytime with any types of questions. But I want to thank everybody for attending, and remember to please fill out the survey if you have some time, and we really appreciate it. Have a great weekend, everybody.